Hi, Cooper Clever 1972, back with another video. When I did my haul of November Barnes & Noble videos, DVDs and basically Blu-rays, there was just one DVD. On the Eclipse 2, I think, was just DVDs. I forgot that I didn't show my Criterion flash sale Blu-rays that I bought. And that was a sale in October. I completely forgot all about it. So I'll show those to you. And then I'll show you a box set, which I think I didn't show you during my, when I showed up my collection. I don't think it was there. And then another DVD that I don't think I showed because both the box set and that DVD were being borrowed at the time. So I'll show you those. So anyways, first Criterion, and then of course, by my name, you know, I'm a Kubrick lover, so of course I'm going to get Barry Lyndon. A friend of mine on YouTube says the aspect ratio is, you know, much, much better than it was like on DVD. You know, the way it was shown in the theaters, I guess, you know. But it looks beautiful. I've watched a little bit of it, and it's loaded to the gills with special features. The Blu-ray has two discs to it, and I think the extra features are long extra features. It's got a documentary with the cast and the crew, audio excerpts from a 76 interview with director Stanley Kubrick, program about the film's groundbreaking visuals featuring focus puller Douglas Milsom and gaffer Lou Bogue, as well as excerpts from a 1980 interview with cinematographer John Alcott. A program featuring historian Christopher Freeling, an Academy Award-winning production design of Ken Adam, interview with editor Tony Lawson, French television interview with from 76 with Ulla Britt Soderlund, who designed the costumes for the film. Interview with critic Michel Simont. Interview with actor Leon Vitali, who was Kubrick's assistant after this film. Well, there's another guy who was his assistant as well. There's a documentary about that guy. He's from Italy. It's called something like Stanley is S is for Stanley. I think that's the title of the movie, the documentary on Netflix. And you can see what he did for Kubrick on that, which is a pretty interesting documentary. But anyways, Leon Vitali was a assistant to Kubrick after Barry Lyndon, you know, like helping with, I don't know if he helped with the casting of Danny Lloyd or if he was just helped him out on the set or something, but he was integral to that production of The Shining. A new piece analyzing the fine art-inspired aesthetics of the film, the curator Adam Eaker, trailers, and an essay by critic Jeffrey O'Brien, and two pieces about the look of the film from the 76th issue of American Cinematographer. So this film is the first film to use Zeiss lenses by Kubrick. He used Mitchell cameras. If you watch a documentary about him on the Kubrick box set, you see that he found out about these Zeiss lenses that NASA was using for satellites or something like telescopes to observe from, I think, space. I think it was before the Hubble telescope, but they allow in a lot of light into the lens, and he bought these Mitchell cameras that are no longer being used, and he got somebody to take a Mitchell camera apart and fit a Zeiss lens on it, and that's so he shot like an available light, which I think is one of the documentaries on here. They talk about how Kubrick used available light rather than additional light, which sort of, even though it's not a bad thing to do, it sort of makes it more artificial and more theatrical, and it's more a natural look with this Barry Lyndon movie, and maybe it wasn't on this, maybe it was on YouTube, I saw this, but there was a documentary about him and how he used natural light, not just in this film, but a lot of his other movies as well. So anyways, it's Barry Lyndon, and you get two discs, and maybe I'll get into more detail about this. If I watch it at some point, I can show it to you. You know, both Blu-rays look the same. There's no difference in them. You know, they're both, if I can, you know, see they're, well, wait a minute, my hand's in the way. Yeah, so, see, they're just same thing. And then, of course, you got the, that nice photo of the British soldiers in Ireland marching. I think it's Ireland. I know the film starts in Ireland, and I think it's still Ireland there. And then, of course, you have this nice booklet. Of course, I could show this in beautiful photographs. Just, I mean, the booklet alone is, you know, beautiful. Some might regard this movie as boring. I think you just have to get into it. It takes its time, and I think that is one of its virtues. I think the reason why it takes its time is because people in this time period, it was a very leisurely kind of society. They were, you know, they didn't really work at all or anything like that. They had people do that for them, basically, because they were, some of these people in here are this is ice lenses. Some of these people in here are royalty, so they're not, you know, they're expected by other people to take care of them, you know, feed them and, you know, tend to the gardens, whatever, you know. Like, you know, there's a scene where you see the shrubbery in the garden. Of course, they didn't cut it. It was the servants or slaves that cut that for them, you know. So, and that's Redmond Barry's, I think it's his uncle. So, yeah, there's a nice classical music score, which I think is Mozart, Frederick the Great. I think they cheated a little, and they chose something that was past the time period of Barry Lyndon, because the time period of Barry Lyndon is the late 1700s. Like, Redmond Barry meets George III of England, King George, and he's either getting ready to, or is involved in the American Revolution at the time. So, of course, you don't see America at the time. He talks, well, I won't say anything about the I won't say anything about the America, like, you'd see it if you saw the movie. That, like, there's a spoiler that I don't really want to reveal, I guess. But the second movie is Sid and Nancy by Alex Cox. This movie is about Sid Vicious of the Sex Pistols and his girlfriend, Nancy. Alan Rickman, I think, plays him. Oh, no, it's Gary Oldman. I thought it was Alan Rickman. And I think Gary Oldman, correct me if I'm wrong, is playing Churchill on the new World War II movie that's coming out this holiday season. And maybe it's Christmas that comes out. I guess I'm showing you more of these. I'm showing you the booklets and articulating or elaborating more on what's in these movies, because, you know, when I showed a few days ago my the Blu-rays I bought from the Barnes & Noble sale this November, I didn't get into too much detail about what they were about. I don't know if I'll get into too much detail. I'm at 10 minutes, so I might try to cut it more short and not elaborate too much. But it's got two audio commentaries featuring co-writer Ebb Wool, actors Gary Oldman and Chloe Webb, cultural historian Greil Marcus, filmmakers Julian Temple and Lech Kowalski, and musician Elliot Kidd. Roger Deakins did the cinematography. He supervised, I guess, the negative. The other commentary is by Alec Cox, who was a co-writer, an actor, and the director, and actor Andrew Schofield. Interview with Cox from 2016, England's Glory, a 1987 documentary on the making of the film. The infamous 1976 Bill Grundy interview with the Sex Pistols on British television. Rare telephone interview with Sid Vicious from 1978. Interviews with Vicious and Nancy Spungen from the 1980 documentary DOA, A Rite of Passage. Excerpts from a 1976 episode of the London Weekend Show about the London punk scene. Excerpts from Sad Vacation, 2016 documentary about Spungen and Vicious. An essay by John Savage, an 86 piece compiled by Cox about Vicious, Spungen, and the making of the film. I think this shows some footage. They do it in the movie, and I think they show the actual footage of when they the Sex Pistols did that song, God Bless, was it God Bless the Queen or whatever that song is. They're on a boat, and I think it's the centennial or something for Queen, and they're singing that song, and these British police come up to their boat and they get them to stop playing it, something like that. If you can clarify what that all is about, you know, you can just put your comments down there. Next up, so now here's two things that I didn't, well, at least one thing that I didn't show in my collection videos because it was being borrowed at the time. It's a box set. I bought these a few sales back, maybe a few years back. America Lost and Found, the BBS story. Head, Easy Rider, Five Easy Pieces, Drive He Said, which is Jack Nicholson's first feature. A Safe Place, Last Picture Show, King of Marvin Gardens. So it's called the BBS story because each letter represents three of the people that founded the BBS, which was only existed for a certain amount of time. I think like the late 60s and through the 70s, maybe mid 70s. First one is Head, which I didn't think was that great because I'm not a fan of the Monkees, really. I guess the Monkees tried to be the American Beatles. I didn't think of that fantastic. But then, let's see, the next one is Easy Rider, which is a good movie. This has got an audio commentary from Dennis Hopper. Another commentary with Peter Fonda, production designer, Paul Lewis, and Dennis Hopper as well. I think both commentaries featured Dennis Hopper, if I'm correct. Some documentaries, Born to Be Wild, and Easy Rider, Shaking the Cage. Interview with BBS co-founder Steve Blauner about, I don't know, just, anyways. So this one comes, this is the DVD BBS film box set. So naturally it has more discs to it than a Blu-ray would. So, you know, I think I bought this. I think I bought this one when I was still living at home. I don't think I had this. I think I've had this for a few years. So, of course, there's another movie called, it's a sequel to Easy Rider. I think it's called The Last Movie, which I saw at the theater at my film fest I attend. But I guess it's not as good as Easy Rider. There's a scene where Dennis Hopper, he's walking down the road. Maybe he's stoned. And he takes off all his clothes and he's just walking naked down the street. It's like in a desert area where he's doing it. And he's sleeping with all these women and just... But it's called... I think it's called The Last Movie. If you know the title, just let me know. I think it's called The Last Movie. Jack Nicholson there. Of course, this features the famous scene about Jack Nicholson trying to order something at a restaurant and trying to have certain things on the sandwich and not other things on the sandwich. And the waitress says, "We don't accept substitutes. You get it as it's ordered on the menu," you know. But it's like Bob Rafelson, the director, said people know that speech even if they haven't seen this film. There's another famous scene. Well, I don't know if it's a famous scene. He's in traffic, and I think he's driving his car, and he stops the car, and there's a piano on the truck, and he gets on the truck, and he starts playing the piano, because in his earlier part of his life, he was a pianist, and his family is a bunch of, I think they're wealthy. They're like artsy kind of people, and he doesn't like being associated with them, so that's why he lives in a... He does oil. He works on an oil rig or whatever because he wants to be amongst lower-class people. I guess it's something like that. I'm getting close to 20 minutes, but that's because this box set is so big, I would say. Next two are Drive-E Set and A Safe Place. Drive-E Set is Jack Nicholson's first feature. It's not that good, in my opinion. And A Safe Place is, I don't know if it's Henry Jaglom's first feature or not. I didn't like that film that much anyways, though. Let me show you what's the inside here. Orson Welles. And of course, he's in the movie A Safe Place. You'll see in one of the special features of the disc that I don't remember the woman who interviewed Peter Bogdanovich and Henry Jaglom, but she interviews them for their films. Of course, Jaglom's is A Safe Place. And Bogdanovich is Last Picture Show. And to me, it seems like she's not paying much attention to Jaglom's film and sort of ignoring him during the interview. But just not ignoring him, just not really talking to him that much and just sort of focusing more on Peter Bogdanovich's film, which is much better film anyways, in my opinion. I think Jaglom's made better films after that, but I can't remember his other movies. I think I've seen some of his other movies or one of his other movies. Next one is a really good movie. And it was shot in black and white. Well, here's Sybil Shepherd and Who is that? Jeff Bridges, I think. When they were really young. There's the film. And there's the supplements. Yeah, it's based on a novel that Peter Bogdanovich's, I think it was his first wife, said, why don't you read that? Because he wasn't really drawn to it when he saw it like in a paperback rack or something, but then he read it and I guess he decided to make it. But it's basically about these kids growing up in a Texas town, Randy Quaid, Sybil Shepherd, Jeff Bridges, Sam Bottoms, Timothy Bottoms, I think it's both brothers, Ellen Burstyn, who plays the mother of Sybil Shepherd. I think his name is Ben Johnson, who's a famous Western actor. Cloris Leachman, who has an affair with one of the young boys. And I think her husband plays the coach of the basketball team. Oh, it's based on the novel of Larry McMurtry's. So, screenplay by Larry McMurtry and Peter Bogdanovich. So, really good movie. And the last one in the box set is The King of Marvin Gardens. This features Jack Nicholson, Bruce Dern, Ellen Burstyn, yeah, I don't remember the other woman. Julianne Robinson. Oh, Benjamin Scatman Crothers is in this. Scatman Crothers was Halloran in The Shining, the black cook. He's in this. I think he plays some kind of a, I don't know if it's a pimp or something. I don't. Maybe he's not a pimp. I don't know. He's some kind of person, some kind of important person. So that's The King of Marvin Gardens. I think I showed this, right? Ellen Burstyn. I think Bruce Dern plays this like con artist, or he's trying to score a lot of money and just nothing ever comes out of it. There's the booklet that comes with the movies. I don't know if I can show all this. It'll take too much time. See how thick it is? It would take forever to get through this. I mean, already 23 minutes. I'm just going to zip through it. Like, just try to take a look. I don't know if I'm really showing it off that well. Let's try it again. Yeah, so, I mean, it's just loaded with special features. This thing is loaded. I mean, it's got a ton of, a ton of special features. Audio commentaries for Head, Easy Rider, Five Easy Pieces, Safe Place. That has pictures show. Selected scene commentary for The King of Marvin Gardens. Hours of new and archival interviews and documentaries. Outtakes, screen tests, TV and radio spots, still galleries and trailers, a booklet featuring essays by critics Chuck Stevens, Matt Zoller, Seitz, Kent Jones, Graham Fuller, and Mark Lefanu, and Jay Hoberman. Jay Hoberman of the Village Voice, of course. So, and of course, the inside of the box set is, looks like a marquee. See? It's kind of hard to see, but anyways, the last thing, I guess it's going to be like a 30-minute video here. This is not a Criterion. They have made a Criterion of it. I don't know if I buy the Criterion. I sort of am happy enough with this one. It's Wings of Desire by Wim Wenders with Peter Falk in it. Bruno Ganz. I think Bruno Ganz played Hitler in Downfall, the German film. It's got audio commentary with director Wim Wenders and Peter Falk. Angel Among Us documentary, interactive map. That's where you can see where the scenes take place in Berlin, and you can go to those. You click on that scene where it takes place in the map, and it takes you there, and it shows you like a scene or maybe what it looks like around. Maybe there's a still photograph of where that scene was shot or something like that. Deleted scenes, the director's commentary, original advertising artwork, and original theatrical trailers. And pretty interesting movie. It was made, I believe, before the Berlin Wall fell. And it's about these angels who are observing this. It's shot in black and white and color. And these angels are observing this environment within Berlin and how people are kind of depressed or whatever. And Peter Falk sort of knows those angels are hovering around and, you know, looking at him. And so it's a pretty interesting film. I like it. It's a good movie. So anyways, that finishes the video. So we've got Wings of Desire, America Lost and Found, the VBS story, which is probably a good purchase, but I don't like everything in it. Like Head, I'm not wild about. I'm not wild about A Safe Place. King of Marvin Gardens, the first time I saw it, I liked it. My hearing is a little bad, so I couldn't hear it very well at the time when I bought this box set. But I think it was not a bad film. So did I say A Safe Place? I didn't like that much. I wasn't wild about that. And of course, Drive, he said, I thought that was just a horrible movie. I know it's Jack Nicholson. I like Jack Nicholson in films like The Shining, One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest. And, you know, I like Jack Nicholson, but that's not a film I really care for. And of course, Sid and Nancy and Barry Lyndon. So I have so many films to watch. You know, I have all these films I just bought for the Criterion sale, which I showed a video, you know, just a previous video passed. And of course, I showed all these videos before my collection. It's going to take forever to get through it all. I don't know if I'll ever be able to watch everything. I mean, you got Netflix streaming, you have to watch that. You don't have to do anything, but, you know, I'd like to watch some of that stuff, like TV shows and movies and documentaries. And I watch some documentaries on there. And then I have another streaming service called Mubi, M-U-B-I, which shows, like, cult movies, foreign films, classic films, avant-garde type films, and they put 30 films per day. They take one off. They put another one on each day. And then, of course, you have the movie theater. I don't really go to the movie theater that much. But if I go, you know, that's another cost. And then movies to borrow from the library, either from the city I live in or the town I work in. Or borrowing them from somebody. So, you know. And I had a recent conversation with somebody, one of my friends, and we were talking about the canon, you know, like the films you have to see before you die, like Citizen Kane or Seven Samurai or Seventh Seal or Bicycle Thieves. And even there you can be deficient because you're going to miss something. So anyways, but I like the fact that I can watch all these films and that they're readily available to me. So, but, you know, anyways, I'm not going to go on anymore. I'm going to stop the video. So thanks for watching. Comments are welcome down below. And thanks for watching. Bye.